Should offensive views expressed by a long-dead movie actor in an interview he gave nearly 50 years ago cause his name to be removed from an airport? That question has been raised about the John Wayne Memorial Airport in Santa Ana, Orange County, California, near Disneyland, 35 miles south of Los Angeles. In 1979, the airport was dedicated to the macho American icon, who was a local resident and had just died of cancer. Wayne starred in more than 150 films, more than half of them Westerns. Nominated for 3 Oscars, he finally won for 1969's True Grit. But in this woke era that has seen the removal of Confederate statues, new attention is being paid to inflammatory quotes from Wayne's interview published in Playboy Magazine, May 1971, like this one. "I believe in white supremacy until the blacks are educated to a point of responsibility." That and more led to this proposal in the LA Times. "It's time to take John Wayne's name off the Orange County Airport." Its author is LA Times columnist Michael Hiltzig. He's here to explain. Also here to respond is Ethan Wayne, the 6th of John Wayne's 7 children. He himself acted in several movies with his late father. Michael, the 1971 interview preceded the naming of the airport, so presumably those who made the decision to name the airport had awareness of these comments.
Sure. I think it was no secret that John Wayne held extreme right-wing views. This was part of his personal persona. The airport was named after him really not because there was any public clamor or community clamor to honor him, but it was part of a political deal so that the airport could get expanded. And the one political leader who opposed that agreed to this deal if John Wayne's name would go on the airport. That's how this happened.
How much of this debate, this conversation, is due to the fact that there have been some real significant changes, politically speaking, in Orange County? You mentioned Orange County to me. I think of the sort of the heart of rockbed conservatism and republicanism. I think of Yorba Linda, Richard Nixon. I think of the John Birch Society having come out of that area. But it's changed.
It's changed dramatically. In fact, the old Orange County was the Orange County we think of from 1971. It was the hive of rock-ribbed conservative republicanism that was exemplified, in fact, by the political views of John Wayne. That Orange County does not exist anymore. It's much more diverse politically. Minorities, ethnic groups have a much stronger voice in Orange County today than they did then. And as we saw in November, when the last remaining Republican members of Congress were turfed out by the voters, it's become right now a 100% Democratic delegation in Congress.
Is it fair, looking through a 2019 lens, to hold John Wayne accountable for things that he said in 1971?
Yeah, I think the fact of the matter is that the views that he expressed in 1971, I think, were extremist even for 1971. That was not a prehistoric period. As I pointed out in my column, the civil rights movement was at high tide at that point. Martin Luther King had been assassinated just 3 years before. In 1964 and 1965, we had federal legislation for civil rights. Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on the Montgomery bus in 1955. So these things were all in the air, and I think John Wayne was reacting to that movement. He wasn't expressing an old view. He was reacting to the advances that we were seeing in the civil rights movement.
Michael Hiltzig, thank you. Joining me now to respond is Ethan Wayne, who's not only John Wayne's son, also president of the John Wayne Enterprises and director of the John Wayne Cancer Foundation. Ethan, this is some real tough stuff. I don't know that you're going to try to defend the words, but let's at least let folks see what they were. Relative to gays, can we start with that? Your father quoted in Playboy magazine, if we can put that on the screen, as saying the following: "Americans will be completely fed up with these perverted films." He's then asked, well, what do you consider perverted? He talks about Midnight Cowboy, a story about two fags, and thinks that qualifies. Relatives to blacks, people of color, but we can't all of a sudden get down on our knees and turn everything over to the leadership of the blacks. "I believe in white supremacy until the blacks are educated to a point of responsibility." And then with regard to Native Americans, one more of these: I don't feel we did wrong in taking this great country away from them, if that's what you're asking. Our so-called stealing of this country from them was just a matter of survival. There were great numbers of people who needed new land, and the Indians were selfishly trying to keep it for themselves. And I did read the full interview because I didn't want to take anything out of context. Respond to that.
Well, thank you for having me on and letting me respond. I think you do have to go to the context of that entire interview. This is an interview that took place over 2 days, and I believe the transcript was about 8 hours long. It was a pretty contentious discussion over politics and the film industry. So if we want to, let's start. I think he started with the gay term. He used the word, he used a terrible word, no doubt about it. But he used it not in the context of an individual's sexuality. He used it in the context of the changing landscape of the motion picture business, something that distressed him. You know, my father worked in Hollywood for 50 years, and Hollywood is probably, you know, one of the most progressive and diverse communities on earth. He didn't care what race, gender, sexual orientation you were. He cared how well you did your job. He took everyone at face value. So the second place you went, I think, was the Native
Blacks.
American question.
Black. Okay, do that one.
Okay. So my father made a mistake that some people make in interviews by repeating the language that the interviewer used. So that's where the term white supremacy came out. In fact, we dug through our archives, and we found notes that my father wrote to people at the time who were concerned about his use of that term, and he explained that it was a mistake on his part. He repeated the interviewer's language. He should have said supremacy of responsible people. If you'll read the entire interview, you'll see that they were discussing a group that he believed was trying to use violence to gain power, and my father would never approve of that. He believed in the democratic system. So lastly, I think he went to the American Indians, Native Americans, and I don't think anybody had a closer relationship to the Native Americans than John Wayne. He's being asked pointedly political questions about an issue that we've dealt with for a century and a half before my father gave the interview, and we're still dealing with it today. You know, it's a complex question. My father had a great personal respect for Native Americans. He worked with them, you know, for half his career. When John Wayne and a film crew would come to Monument Valley or to a reservation, it was an economic boon for that tribe and those people. They appreciated him, and I think anyone who knew him would remember him fondly. He had a great respect for them as a people and for their art and culture.
How concerned are you? I know you're speaking to me from Irvine in Orange County, where I'm sure it's a great matter of pride to the Wayne family to have that airport named for your dad. How concerned are you that there'll be this groundswell and that 9-foot statue will come down and that the airport will lose its name?
Well, obviously, we don't want our father attacked, and we don't want to be smirched by someone who's taking, you know, words from an interview that's 8 hours long and using them out of context. Look, they put my father's name on that airport for the same reason that that Congress voted to give him a congressional gold medal, for the same reason that the president decided to give him a Medal of Freedom. And it's recognition of a lifetime of significant contributions to this country, his community, and to his industry. I think it would be an injustice to judge someone based on an interview that's being used out of context. They're trying to contradict how he lived his life, and how he lived his life was who he was. So any discussion of removing his name from the airport should include the full picture of the life of John Wayne and not be based on a single outlier interview from half a century ago.
The argument being that those quotes are not reflective of the interview in total, or at least of the transcript of all that was recorded over the course of those 2 days.
Correct.
And
you're taking a quote where he uses a harsh term in relation to homosexuality. But he's not talking negatively about homosexuality. He's talking about the negative direction that the film industry is taking in regard to sexual violence and nudity. And so we spent much more time in the article discussing the violence of a film called The Wild Bunch. He had a formula for delivering family entertainment in a way that's still appreciated today. And when he saw people coming in and trying to add a little bit more to sell more tickets, it was distressing to him. He thought it was bad for the film industry, and I think he thought it was bad for the fabric of the country in general, you know, chipping away, desensitizing people to nudity, sex, and violence.